Right, so good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. My name is David Graus, and I'm here today to talk about algorithmic matching, bias, and bias mitigation. So first, a brief introduction about myself. I started my academic career in media studies, and then through a master program, I ended up in a PhD program, which was about information retrieval. And information retrieval is a technology that's behind many search and match solutions. Then I also have a bit of experience in industry, so I started out in between my bachelor's and master's working in media as an editor for radio and online programs. And then since my PhD, I started working as a data scientist in different fields. So 2 years ago, I was at a media company where we worked on personalization of news. And since early this year, I'm employed at Randstad. And while the domains may be very different, the underlying technology that we use there is quite similar, which I'll explain today in this talk. So in this talk, I would like to share a few things with you, and we put this in the context of the hackathon. So the hackathon today is about the future of equal opportunities in the labor market, and more specifically about automated system processes for assessing and selecting candidates. So ideally, as far as I'm concerned, at the end of this talk, you'll get the following things out of it. So first, I hope you get some insights into how these systems work in practice. Next, I hope that you get some insights into the challenges, but also the opportunities of deploying these systems. Finally, hopefully you get some inspiration for your own project. And if all else fails, at least you get a lot of reading material, as I'll share all my sources at the end of this talk. So the talk is structured as follows. I would first like to introduce a bit about Randstad, about what we do. And then I want to zoom into one particular project that we're working on that's very relevant in the context of this hackathon. Finally, I will talk a bit more generally about bias, specifically in the domain of automated hiring. And I will also highlight some of the opportunities I see for mitigating bias in the same domain. Then at the end, I will part you with some parting thoughts. So first, Randstad. So this is the mandatory corporate slide that I'll have to share with you. So what is Randstad? We are the global leader in the HR services industry. These were last year's numbers, so we made almost 24 billion euros in revenue. We have almost 5,000 offices across 38 countries, and we put 650,000 people to work every day. We're headquartered in Diemen. We've been founded in 1960, which means that we have turned 60 this year. Happy birthday to us. So what do we do? So we do plenty of, we offer plenty of services in the HR industry. Here's a small overview. So staffing is about the temporary and permanent placement of employees in certain domains, so in manufacturing, logistics, and administrative jobs. We're active in the professionals domain, which is kind of similar, both temp and permanent placements. But in a slightly different domain. So here we're working with experienced professionals and managers with academic or equivalent qualifications. We also offer a bunch of other services, but for the sake of this talk, I will be focusing on the staffing domain, which is also the biggest chunk of our business. Now, before I continue, it is good to share that we have some beliefs at Randstad. And one that's of particular relevance in this talk is our tech and touch belief. So we know from our heritage, we've been around since 1960, that real connections are not made exclusively through data and algorithms. They also require human involvement. So our tech and touch belief revolves around the idea of having a strong technological and data-driven foundation, but always to combine it with a human touch. And I think this is a very central message to the talk I'll be giving today, is that humans are always involved and technology should aim to support the human process. But I'll get back with a few examples later. Now, more specifically, we also have published our own AI principles in which we kind of lay out the guidelines of how we develop algorithms. So there's a bunch of different guidelines we have, but of particular interest in this talk is that we aim for transparency and explainability, and more importantly, we aim for fairness and inclusivity by design. Right, so who do we do this with? So these are the data scientists we have employed at Randstad Groep Nederland. And I'm showing you this slide because we're quite numerous, but it's important to note that all of our data scientists are embedded in different teams across the organization, across different departments. So we have people at IT, but we have people at marketing and finance as well, which means that we're not on an island and there's actually quite open communication across the different teams. Another thing that you may notice that's hard to ignore in this context is that we have more data scientists called Peter than we have women. This is something that's, that we're quite aware of and we're trying to address. But at the same time, in terms of age and nationalities, we do quite well on diversity. So what do these people work on? So we have a few example projects that I would like to mention. The first one being the Skills Taxonomy project. In this project, we aim to extract structured information out of unstructured data. So think of extracting skills or education from resumes, from vacancy texts. And we do this to, for example, improve our matching algorithms, but also to get some market insights. Next, we work on revenue forecasting, because by now we have quite efficient time series forecasting algorithms. So we're trying to kind of predict how we're going to do in the future. Another project revolves around churn prediction. So this is a task of trying to predict whether a client might stop using our services and taking action before that happens. The final project that I would like to highlight is SmartMatch. And SmartMatch is our project around algorithmic matching, around search, and around recommender systems. And this project is of particular interest for this talk, so I will be zooming in to this. So before we start, I would like to give a brief introduction on algorithmic matching. What exactly is algorithmic matching? Now, I would like to illustrate this with an example that we may all know, especially in the pandemic times. You may have come across this website, Netflix. Now, if I show you my personal recommendations, I actually expose my soul a bit, but these are my personal recommendations. But this is algorithmic matching. So what Netflix tries to do is it tries to infer my preferences and based on that, recommend movies to me. Now, Netflix isn't the only one. You may know Spotify does the same. And for me personally, actually, a lot of new music I find through the recommender systems. Historically, this has been done a lot in e-commerce. So Amazon was one of the first that really pioneered this technology, for example, by showing all the books that people bought that also bought the book you're looking at. So the core of this technology is that you use machine learning algorithms to surface relevant and related content. So what is there to match at Randstad? Well, like I said, we are very active in the matching industry. And if you would simplify our model, we have these three entities. We have talents, that are the people that are looking for jobs. We have our recruiters that sit in between the jobs and the recruiters. And we have the jobs. So SmartMatch aims to sit in the middle of this. Now, how does it sit in the middle of this? It aims to do the following things. So the ambition of SmartMatch is to enable Randstad's digital strategy by using technology to enable recruiters to improve the matching process. So again, it's important to underline here that this is a product that aims to improve the human process. So the goal of SmartMatch is to provide Randstad with flexible, up-to-date, reliable, and optimal search and match solutions. So here again, it's important to note we're working on searching and matching in technology. So what does it look like in the real world? We have a few products. One example is our job recommender. So this product recommends jobs to job seekers. And as you may see by the layout, this resembles a bit the Netflix example. So you register on our website, you add some information about what you're looking for, and we'll be able to surface the jobs that we think are relevant to you. So what's under the hood of this system? So the goal is to offer the best matching vacancies for any talent that comes in. Technically, we approach this bit of a complicated story, but we have a hybrid recommender system that uses part matrix factorization. It's a very traditional approach to doing recommendation systems, which is trained on the click behavior of our talents. And we combine that with an embedding-based capability matching algorithm. I won't go into details, but it suffices to say that it's of sufficient complexity. What did we see when we deployed this system? So we saw an uplift of 27% in application rates. That means that we had an uplift of 27% of talents that started applying for jobs. Now, why is it important to share this? I think it really shows that investing in these type of systems really pays off. I mean, we get an increase in our important business metrics. So another project we have is called the Talent Recommender. And this is a project that's quite interesting because it sits in between the talent and the jobs, and it aims to help the recruiter to find the right talents for a job. So in this system, you'll have a recruiter may put in their own job request, and a job request is represented by, for example, the company at which your job is, by some metadata like what's the salary, the amount of hours a week. And by submitting this job request, a recruiter will get an automated list of candidates that are deemed relevant to this job. Now, again, a bit of background. The goal of this system is to recommend suitable talents to recruiters for any given job request. And we approach this with a machine learning model that's trained on historic placements to rank talents based on the probability they will be hired. So it is important to note that here we use historic data, and for that reason, I think it's an interesting project to highlight further in this talk. But before I do, we have a few results. So what we saw is that before we had our matching engine, in on average 14% of all the search queries, a relevant candidate would be surfaced, would be found by a recruiter. And in our matching solution, this number is almost double that. So that means that in 28% of the cases we generate a recommendation, there is a relevant candidate in that set. What does this mean? This doesn't mean that our recruiters don't search anymore, but it means that with relatively low effort, we can surface relevant candidates. Okay, so like I said, this project is interesting to highlight because it deals with historic data on the one hand. It's very tech and touch. It sits in between the recruiter and the talent. So I would like to dive a bit deeper into how this system works. So the central concept here is that we learn from historic placements. So if I would illustrate that with a simple example, you could imagine we have a job in mechanics and we have three candidates. So we have an IT guy, we have a mechanic, and we have a doctor. We know historically that the mechanic got placed and the other ones didn't get placed. And if you would collect all of these jobs, here's another one. We have an IT job, we have a construction worker as an applicant, we have a cook and an IT person, and the IT person gets placed. So using this historic data, we train a machine learning algorithm to distinguish between two classes, between the classes of matching pairs and non-matching pairs. So here we collected all the pairs from the two historic jobs, and we train a machine learning model. All right, so I'm going to explain to you a bit about how this works, but it's going to be a simplification because it includes a bit of magic, but I'm just going to explain the process. So we have a sample, a positive sample of a mechanic that got placed in a mechanic job. What do we do to train a machine learning model? So we need to represent this pair in a way that a computer can understand. So what we do is we extract features. So you can imagine one feature of the candidate would be that she lives in Amsterdam. A feature of the job could be that the job is also in Amsterdam. We could assign a score of 1 because they match. Another feature could be work experience. So we know this person has worked as a mechanic before. We know the job is a mechanic job. So that's also a matching feature. Then we can look at education history. We can see that our candidate has an MBO diploma, and this is required for the job, so another match. We can do the same for all the negative pairs. So here we have an IT person for the mechanic job, and we can look at, for example, where they live. Turns out this candidate lives in Utrecht, the job is in Amsterdam, doesn't match, no score. We can see that this person has experience in IT, the job is in mechanics, so there's no score. But at the same time, there could be features that do score, so this person may have an HBO diploma, which matches with the minimum requirement of an MBO diploma. This is a simplification, but if you would add all these numbers, you would be able to tell that the first candidate scores higher than the second, and thus is more suitable for this job. Of course, in the real world, this is a bit more complex. It's not a matter of summing up a few numbers. The scoring part in particular is much more complex. We use machine learning to actually learn the scores. So what I showed in the previous slides is that a match is a plus one, a non-match is a zero. In the real world, we automatically learn those scores. At the same time, this model may be able to pick up combinations. So it may be able to learn that in some professions, the distance to the job is not as important as in other professions. In our actual system, our features are also much more complex and much more numerous. We have many more of them. And finally, I can show a bit about what's under the hood, because the features we have, they fall into three distinct categories. So we have, for example, a capability matcher, That's kind of similar to what I showed with the work experience. This model knows what a candidate has done, what kind of experience a candidate has, and knows what is required in the job request. Another model we have is related to the preference of the talent. So you can imagine that the talent has certain requirements with respect to minimum salary or maximum travel distance. This is also incorporated in the model. Finally, we have a model that estimates the availability of the candidates. And here the idea is that we have many candidates in our database, but for a recruiter, it's not really useful if we recommend a candidate that is not actively looking for a job. So now the big question of this hackathon, what about bias? So I want to explain two things, one about the technology and one about the human aspect of bias. So there are some measures you can take, there are some design decisions you can make to reduce the risk of bias in your model. The first one is that we do not model these protected attributes. The model is not aware of gender, age, and nationality. So that means the model will not and cannot explicitly explicitly discriminate simply because the model doesn't have this information. Another important aspect is that our historic data comes from very diverse sources. So an often heard criticism of these algorithmic matching systems is that there's a feedback loop and a self-fulfilling prophecy. In our case, our historic placements may come from either placements that were made by recruiters without using the system, or it can come through talents that apply themselves. So because you have very many different sources, the model stays more broad and doesn't get stuck in its own bias. All right, finally, our model is trained to learn to predict matches between a candidate and a job and doesn't rely on trying to predict the employability of a talent in isolation of this match. And this is an important distinction because we focus on the overlap between the talent profile and a job request, and we use our own structured data. That means that we can control our feature space and we don't use unstructured data. I'll show an example later how that can go wrong. The other part is the human touch aspect. So in our case, we have a recruiter, we have talent. So the recruiter has control in this scenario. The recommendations that we generate are but one source. They're complementary to many others. So the recruiter can always pick up the phone, call a talent. Talents come walking into the office. The recruiter can use a search engine. So there's many different ways in which these matches can be made. And it sounds kind of obvious, but it's very important to stress that this technology is just part of a bigger system, a bigger tool set. The talent likewise has control. So on the one hand, the talent can change their preferences, for example, their salaries, the minimum salaries, maximum travel distance, which changes how they are recommended in the system. Finally, like the recruiters, talents can always still actively apply through other ways. So they can still walk into offices, they can still call, they can go online. That's important to stress is that the technology here is just one part of a bigger ecosystem. Okay, so that's a bit about our scenario. Now I would like to dive a bit deeper into the bigger context. So what is bias in automated hiring? This is a small reminder if you didn't know yet. Bias in HR is everywhere. So I find this picture in a paper that I'll discuss later, but I think it very effectively shows all the different sources of bias. So if you start at the left-hand side, we see the world is distributed in a certain way that may or may not be fair. And then as a next step, you have a candidate pool, which is always a subset of this world population, which may be a non-random subset, right? So there might be a different type of bias in this set. Then we have our screening algorithm, which could be a black box, but outcomes a candidate slate. So outcomes a list of candidates, they may also exhibit a certain bias. Now there's a human decision maker, to some extent also a black box decision, and outcomes a bunch of recommendations, again a subset of the previous candidate slate, again it may exhibit different bias. So we know that there's bias in humans, and we've known this for a long time. This is a paper from 1999. I think the type of research has been repeated many times since. The idea is very straightforward. You take a CV, you change the name, you send it out to people, you collect responses, and then you see whether there's a big difference across genders. So what they found here in 1999 is that both men and women were more likely to hire male job applicants than female job applicants when the records were identical. Now, similar to this, but in a different domain, is the following paper. So where it was gender discrimination before, now we're talking about racial discrimination. So the method was quite similar, only here they used white sounding names and African American sounding names. And they found that white names receive 50% more callbacks for interviews. So I think it's clear that even with no algorithms involved, there will be this persistent bias. However, in algorithms, there is bias as well. Okay, so this is quite a famous example of Amazon, which is already a few years old, but this was an algorithm that was trained to filter resumes based on the employability of a candidate. Now, Amazon themselves, they found out that the algorithm implicitly learned to penalize resumes that include the word women's, for example, because this word was more common in their negative class than it was in their positive class. So this is the example I was talking about before. When you don't control your feature space, your model may pick up correlations that do not reflect the actual employability of a candidate, but that captures other aspects. Another example of where there's bias in algorithms was this study where people tried to measure the bias that was in search engines for resumes. So these were just public websites, and they found something similar. So they found that there was a slight penalty against feminine candidates in the results of this search engine. So that's a bit problematic, but the question is what can we do? And as it turns out, we can do quite a bit. So I would like to tell you a bit about algorithmic bias mitigation. But before I do, a bit of context about the rise of AI and fairness. So like I showed before, the Amazon example, this started in the popular media when you saw that there was a lot of attention for these type of problems. We now see in litigation and in the legal domain, we also see a lot of attention. So this was a report that was published by the EU, which contains guidelines for trustworthy AI. In the Netherlands, we had something similar. So we have reports on labor market discrimination. And in this report by TNO that was published last year, there was also special attention of the role of technology in labor market discrimination. Finally, in the academic world, we see a lot of attention as well. So this conference has been running since 2018, and it is very interdisciplinary. So you have people, you have computer scientists, legal scholars, and social scientists that all join this conference to talk about fairness and accountability and all these related aspects. Now, as you may have surmised, I am into recommender system and recommendations. So these are my personal recommendations for two books that are both written by computer scientists that really give you some hands-on tools to work with mitigating, preventing, and understanding bias in algorithms. But as I promised, I would give you some examples of bias mitigation in the field of automated HR. So I have the following example of representational ranking, which is a paper that was published by LinkedIn. And the idea is very straightforward. So the idea is you have an algorithm that ranks candidates, as we have. And the idea here is to apply representation ranking. What is representation ranking? That is to make sure that the proportion, the distribution of female candidates is the same in the output of your algorithm as it is in the input. So if we would go back to this picture, the idea here is to make sure that your candidate pool and your candidate slate represents the same distribution. So this is quite a straightforward approach to model fairness. And what they found is that it resulted in an improvement in their fairness metric, which makes sense. But more importantly, it didn't change the business metrics. And this is important to note because it means it didn't improve it, but it didn't decrease it either. And that means that by now it is deployed to all LinkedIn recruiter users worldwide. At least at the time of writing. Now you can take it one step further, and in the next example, they do exactly that. So here the idea is, can you fix the human bias by overcompensating in your candidate slate? Turns out you can. So they found that balancing gender representation, so overcompensating gender representation, can correct for biases in some of the professions. But at the same time, it couldn't in other professions. So the examples they had here were in nannies or gynecologists. The idea there, if you even put more men in your candidate slate, the people were still more likely to pick the women candidates. An important side note here is that they did this study with crowdsourcing, which would of course be different if you have professional recruiters that are aware of bias. So what did they find? They found that there were a lot of factors that affected the decision-making process. So the gender of the decision maker was one, the complexity of the task was another, the over and under representation of genders was another. So what does this work tell us? It tells us that human bias always remains at play. It tells us there are many factors that affect this, and it tells us there is no silver bullet. But at the same time, technology can help in some cases. So I would like to wrap up with these thoughts. Like I hopefully showed you, bias is everywhere. It's both in humans and the world. It's also in algorithms and data. But important to note is that we can and should preemptively minimize the risk of bias through system design. So this is about how you design your features, how you design your models. We can also actively employ technology to mitigate bias in automated and in human-in-the-loop systems, as I've shown in the past two examples. And also, technology should always be considered complementary to the human touch, and full reliance on only technology can be a bit tricky. Finally, I hope that I've been able to convince you that this is a novel, emerging, and very exciting field of research, which is already being applied in practice. So if you want to know more, there's four of our expert colleagues available during the hackathon. Please reach out to them and they'll be happy to help you. Thank you very much for your attention. And as I promised, I have a big reading list for you to look at. Thank you.